Harper Audio presents Why Bob Dylan Matters by Richard F. Thomas, read by Nick Landrum. Chapter 1. Why Does Dylan Matter to Us? There's a moment when all old things become new again. Bob Dylan. Bob Dylan's Blonde on Blonde was one of two albums I packed in the trunk I sent from New Zealand to Ann Arbor, Michigan, in the early summer of 1974. The other was Songs of Leonard Cohen. I was 23 years old and had sold off the rest of my record collection to finance a two-month backpacking trip through Greece before starting my doctoral studies at the University of Michigan. The trip to Greece was my first, but I had been fascinated by the Greeks and Romans since the age of 9, growing up in Auckland, New Zealand, half a world away from where their civilizations rose and fell. I arrived in Ann Arbor on August 18, 1974, days after Richard Nixon resigned from the presidency, ready to begin my professional life as a scholar and teacher of classical literature. My trunk finally arrived in October, and its familiar contents were a welcome sight. Along with the survivors of my record collection, that trunk contained the few classical texts I had accumulated as an undergraduate. The writings of Homer and Virgil, the epic poets of Greece and Rome, along with Sappho, Catullus, Horace, and Ovid, the brilliant lyric poets and love poets whose work captures what it means to live and love, to win and lose, to grieve and celebrate, and to grow old and die. For 2,000 years, their poetry has fired the minds and imaginations of philosophers and poets, painters, sculptors, and musicians, dreamers and lovers. For the past 40 years, as a classics professor, I've been living in the worlds of the Greek and Roman poets, reading them, writing about them, and teaching them to students in their original languages and in English translation. I have for even longer been living in the world of Bob Dylan's songs. And in my mind, Dylan long ago joined the company of those ancient poets. He is part of that classical stream whose spring starts out in Greece and Rome and flows on down through the years, remaining relevant today, and incapable of being contained by time or place. That's how Dylan matters to me, and that's what this book is about. From the beginning of his musical career, Bob Dylan has been working with artistic principles and attitudes toward composition, revision, and performance that bear many similarities to those of the ancients. He has also been living and writing in a world that bears many striking similarities to that of the ancient Romans, whose republic was the model on which the founding fathers built our own system. I believe that Dylan early on came to recognize this similarity, and it has been reflected in the worlds he creates for us in his music ever since. Cullen Murphy's 2007 book, Are We Rome?, addresses this question, arguing that our time, Dylan's time, looks quite a bit like, for the most part, that of the Romans at various moments in their more than 1,000-year history. According to Cullen, the ties that bind the two cultures include the condition of being a superpower, tensions caused by ethnic differences, the persistent memory of civil wars long after the last battle was fought, a sense of the fragility of political structures and decline of the human condition, the relaxation of moral and religious bonds, and a push back against the countercultures. At the heart of it, Rome around the last century BC and the beginnings of the first century AD, and America in the second half of the 20th, share a sense of modernity, by which I mean a few things. By then, Rome had more or less established herself as the dominant power in the Mediterranean world. The absence of serious external enemies, along with the sheer size of her empire, led to competing struggles among those whose task it was to govern the state and extend and defend its vast borders. Starting in the middle of the century, these competing forces clashed, and a series of civil wars led to the elimination, by death on the battlefield, murder, and assassination, of one figure after another, along with the defeat of the ideals or interests they represented. The names are well known: Pompey the Great, Julius Caesar, Brutus, Mark Antony, all killed in a succession of bloody civil wars that went on for 18 years. By around 30 BC, Augustus Caesar, the last man standing, delivered the final blow to the Republic and stepped in as the first emperor of Rome. This period of political uncertainty coincided with the emergence of a brilliant succession of poets and other writers, as happens at moments of political and national crisis or greatness. Athens in the 5th century BC, Elizabethan England, America and Great Britain between the two world wars, the rise of the so-called moderns. Such moments give rise to a heightened sense of the past, along with uncertainties about the future. In each of these periods, new art forms responded to what was happening, disrupting the old forms and traditions, busting them up, renewing what had gone before, moving into uncharted territory. The Roman poets in question will become familiar in the pages that follow: Catullus, Virgil, Horace, and Ovid. Others would have filled out their ranks, but their texts did not survive the centuries. Their art addressed the large issues of their day, the perilous state of their world, and the aftermath of civil war. Similarly, Dylan's art would speak to the horrors of the wars of his day, the Second World War and the Cold War that followed, historic episodes like the Cuban Missile Crisis, and the fear of nuclear warfare, eventually Vietnam, even Iraq. And in both cases, through music and poetry that would prove to be enduring, memorable, and meaningful to ages beyond their own, Dylan and the ancients explore the essential question of what it means to be human. Dylan's songs have been part of my song memory since my mid-teens, but it would be decades before they became more fully aligned in my mind with the Greek and Roman poets I was beginning to read back then. And it was chiefly in the 21st century that Dylan started to reference, borrow from, and creatively reuse their work in his own songs. I first began to make the connection after a trip to the coast of Normandy, where I had been invited in the spring of 2001 to give a lecture at the University of Caen on Virgil and other Roman poets. My host, Catherine Mason, a linguistics professor there, met me at the train station. She suggested that instead of touring the town, pretty much pummeled out of its historical state before the D-Day invasion of June 6, 1944, we might head for the beach. That sounded good to me, so I followed her to the parking lot. As we got into her car and she turned the keys in the ignition, music came blasting from her car's stereo. As we've all done, she had gotten out of the car earlier without thinking to turn down the volume, and the familiar bars of Dylan's Idiot Wind, then and now one of my favorite songs, urgently interrupted our tentative conversation. "You hurt the ones that I love best and cover up the truth with lies. One day you'll be in the ditch, flies buzzing around your eyes, blood on your saddle." Our conversation quickly turned to Dylan, to that song and its importance. For Catherine, a single mother who had recently gone through a divorce, and an American expatriate bringing up two young sons in France, the breakup song had powerful personal resonance. She had gotten hooked on Dylan 25 years after I had, with his 1990 album Under the Red Sky, whose nursery rhyme and fairy tale traditions became part of the rhythm of bringing up her two young sons. As we walked on what had been Sword Beach, landing point for the British 3rd Division on D-Day, she talked about her plans for a conference on the performance art of Dylan. Did I want to give a paper at her conference, and maybe even co-edit the proceedings into a volume? She asked. I said, sure, not really knowing how I would find a way into the topic. But in the back of my mind, I was thinking about how the songs from Dylan's 1997 album, Time Out of Mind, had lately begun somehow to remind me of the work of the Roman poets. Still, I had yet to share this insight with anyone. It was not until many months after my trip to Caen, soon after September 11, 2001, the day that permanently changed the modern world, that what I would present at the Dylan conference became clear to me. Dylan's album, Love and Theft, came out on that day, and I bought it at the Tower Records in Cambridge, Massachusetts, in a daze, in the hours after the towers in New York had been leveled. When I eventually listened to the album, I heard Virgil, loud and clear, in the 10th verse of Lonesome Day Blues. I'm gonna spare the defeated. I'm gonna speak to the crowd. I'm gonna spare the defeated, boys. I'm gonna speak to the crowd. I'm going to teach peace to the conquered. I'm gonna tame the proud. The idiom, rhymes, and music of these lines belong to Dylan, but the thought and diction, rearranged by Dylan, came from Rome's greatest poet, Virgil. In Dylan's lyrics, I recognized these lines from Virgil's Aeneid, spoken by Anchises, father of Aeneas, the mythical founder of Rome. Anchises, who had died on the journey from Troy to Sicily, instructs his son from the underworld on just how Rome is to rule the world. But yours will be the rulership of nations. Remember, Roman, these will be your arts: to teach the ways of peace to those you conquer, to spare defeated peoples, tame the proud. Virgil, Aeneid 6, 851-53, translation Mandelbaum. Suddenly, when I heard Virgil's lines echoed in Dylan's song, my paper topic was obvious. Bob Dylan's performance artistry ended up taking place in Caen in March 2005, and I brought along my younger daughter, who was a college freshman at the time and a veteran of a few Dylan concerts. I was delighted and surprised that she'd chosen to spend her first college spring break with her father at a Bob Dylan conference. But that was the point. I'd taken her and her sister along to academic conferences before, where they would generally disappear into whatever city we happened to find ourselves. But at the Dylan conference in Normandy, things were different. My daughter attended every event, and even joined the Dylanologists for after-dinner Dylan trivia games. We were even treated to a Hendrix-style rendition of Dylan's All Along the Watchtower by Catherine Mason's teenage sons. I was astonished to see their enthusiasm, but perhaps I shouldn't have been. When I see the younger generation of Bob fans, like my daughter's or Catherine Mason's sons, or the students in my freshman seminar, engage with his work, it is a testament to the intergenerational nature of his work and how his art endures. In 2003, between my trips to Normandy, I decided to submit a proposal to the freshman seminar program at Harvard for a course on Dylan, the first of its kind, to my knowledge. The seminar was eventually approved by the faculty committee responsible for selecting these courses, though not without a fight. I later heard from a friend and member of the committee who had supported my proposal of pushback from some quarters. What's he going to do, sit there and listen to Highway 61 Revisited with his students? Was the general attitude. Well, yes, it would be hard not to include that song in the course. My friend had countered that my proposal was no different and no less appropriate than putting in to teach the works of T.S.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.